risen this morning. Thank you, Lord. We praise you. What a powerful name you have, Lord Jesus. And Lord, you're looking to us to have an expectation and a desire for your presence to make all the difference in our lives. I just feel that that's a word from the Lord, that he's looking for expectation and desire to mix together. He wants wet water walkers rather than dry boat Christians. And so let's step out in faith this year. Let's trust him for things. Let's not play it safe all the time, but let's stretch our faith to meet with him so that heaven can be on earth in our lives. Thank you, Lord. We commit this time to you. May you prosper the word to our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You know, we've has just started a new series, God's Blueprint for Your Life. So this is part two. Last week it was the power of blessing. And I thought it was fitting that the Lord put it on my heart to speak that blessing over us, because he, according to that passage that we read about Balaam, the prophet who was hired to do evil to Israel, well, he finally got the message that God was determined to bless Israel. Determined. God is determined. So Almighty God is determined to bless us. But obviously he won't override our individual wills. And so our expectation and our desire and our faith reaching and grasping in a restful way for his provision and protection and purpose for this year ahead is where the connection is made. Amen. So I want to encourage you in that area. We are going to look at some aspects of the blueprint of God's plan for our lives through the lens of the book of Acts. And so this is what we have here. We have a nice lens that we have here in the book of Acts. And we can ask the question, as we will in a moment, why is it that the book of Acts was written to us? Why is it? So we're going to be looking at a macro view, a big picture view, as well as a microscopic a small view, because sometimes I found growing up in high school and just in life that once I saw things in context in the bigger picture, then I understood better what was required for me individually. And so I think if we see the big picture of God's plan as outlined in the book of Acts and elsewhere, obviously in the New Testament especially, but we will be able to fit in and participate in our individual ways and feel that we're not just a lump on the log, but we've actually got something of value to contribute and participate in. And so when we distill things down and try to answer the question, why Jesus came, a lot of people will come up with different ideas. But really, when you distill it down, we see the Old Testament prophets prophesy of Christ, the scriptures there. The Gospels present Christ in his reality of heaven, you know, Christ on earth, God on earth, Emmanuel, God with us. And then the book of Acts and the epistles proclaim his finished work. And I think that expression there, his finished work, is significant. We trot it out. It's a theological expression of what Jesus did on the cross there. But if his work is finished, and he's seated at the right hand of the Father, because when you're seated, it's as if you have finished what you need to do. When you stand up, it's as if there's an expectation that you're going to do something. So Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. His work is complete. What then is there left for you and I to do but to have faith in his completed work, and then express that in a natural way as we just go about our business, in our words, in our deeds, in our actions, in our reactions. We don't have to create anything. It's all being created. It's all being provided for. So the big question of why is so important. A lot of people look at the next level of questions, how, and they focus on that. And then other people say, well, what is it that I must do in the body of Christ? What is it about my life this year ahead that I must focus on? But if we don't answer the big question, why, and then spin down into how are we supposed to go about the why, the what, if we focus on the what, we're just going to be running around all busy like ants somewhere, not really knowing what the purpose for our lives is. And so I believe, if we look at the next statement there, Jesus came primarily to seek and to save the lost. He didn't come to reform us and modify our behavior and improve society and bring justice, although all of those things are outworkings of salvation. But he came primarily to seek and to save the lost. The lost are unsaved. We need salvation. We can't do it alone. We need an injection of the life of God in us to save us. Amen? And so when we look at people that are struggling and look at the stuff on the TV and the shootings and the airport stuff and, you know, just the violence and the overseas goings on and whatever is happening, there's no ways in which they can be truly solved at the root level without a Savior, Jesus Christ. And then translate that back into our happenings and the things and going on in our family and in our jobs and whatever it is. It can only happen when Jesus' salvation is brought to the party, so to speak. And then it goes on, the statement here, and to build his church, a corporate church, which is the universal body of Christ, and then a local church like this here, according to a pattern. And so we want to explore some of those aspects of it. And so a vital church grows now. When we start to look at the book of Acts here, from chapter 2, which we referenced earlier on, verse 40 through to 47, we see some fascinating things here. Look at the first verse there, verse 40. And with many other words, he, that's Peter now preaching on the day of Pentecost, he exhorted them saying, quote unquote, be saved. You see that word salvation again? From this perverse generation. Now, of course, if you think the current generation is really cool, we're slowly evolving into a better community, and if we can just pass a new set of legislation, if we can just repeal some other legislation and executive orders, then everything is going to fall into place. Not so. History shows that without God and his righteousness injection, the nation will not be exalted. No amount of legislation, no amount of military might, no amount of this, that, and the next thing that we typically focus on, let's say we as a society, as a culture, will do it. But we have to be saved from a perverse generation. Amen? Amen. Then those who gladly received this word were baptized in water, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. Now imagine if Peter was a TV evangelist. Man, he could write a book about that day. The day of Pentecost, you know, the purpose of Pentecost. That was a great moment. From a few days before, where the city was in an uproar, where there was a heaviness upon the city because of the cross and Jesus going through the suffering of taking sin on the cross on our behalf, freeing us from that, and then the death, and then the confusion and the fear amongst the disciples, and just the stirring in the society as a whole. A few days later, on the day of Pentecost, there's this massive explosion of God's grace where 3,000 people are added to the church. 3,000 people, I'm sure there were some that called for Jesus' crucifixion at that moment where they said, give us Barabbas or give us Jesus. They called for the crucifixion of Jesus. Just the mob sentiment at that moment. I believe there were some people there in that 3,000 that were saved. Looking at verse 42 now, these people then that were added to them, the disciples, the original disciples, 120 that were there on the day of Pentecost, they continued steadfastly, and I want you to notice four things here. The apostles' doctrine. Wow, doctrine is kind of important. And fellowship, or in the Greek, koinonia, which is a common participation in a common cause, the cause of Christ. Participation. It's not fellowship where you bring some stuff from Costco or QFC and you sit around and have some coffee, which is fine. I mean, that's called coffee and cookies. It's not called biblical fellowship. Fellowship is what you're doing. You're participating by your attendance at church, by your prayers, by translating the life that God imparts to you, let's say through this ministry, into your families, into your community, into your lifestyle. You're participating in a common cause. We're joining together. This is a group that you've joined together with by relationship. And so that's what fellowship means there. Then the third thing, in the breaking of bread, that's why we have bread broken on a regular basis, to keep the finished work of what Jesus did on the cross through his broken body and his shed blood central to what we're doing. Yes, it can become religious. Yes, it's the kind of thing where you just do it and you go through the motions. But every little moment, as that girl, little girl shared there, if we take those little moments and we inject our faith into them and say, God, later on when I participate of this communion, I'm going to remember with thanksgiving that your body was broken for me and my family, right? And your blood was shed for the forgiveness of my sins, that I can stand before you without a sense of shame and of guilt and of regret, but I can stand before you with thanksgiving and praise and worship that I am your child. You've accepted me in the beloved. You can do that every time. And it'll make a difference. Your world will be immeasurably better. Amen. And so we move right along to verse 44. Now all who believed worked together. This is where communism is found in the Bible, according to some. They say they were all together, they had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods, and divided them among all as anyone had need. Okay, so what we're going to do at the end of the service is we're going to take your checkbooks, and we're going to take your credit cards, we're going to put them on the table, and we're just going to mix them up. And whoever wants to pick whatever one and lay a charge on the Amazon, have at it, because this is the way Christianity should be lived, according to certain cults. Okay? No, I think, not to try and water this down a little bit here, they certainly did this. And then later on in Acts chapter 4, you see it happening again. But what was happening, there was a sense of community that was developing. That if there was a need, if someone had a need that could be met by that community, then they would do it. It wasn't some cheap form where an elite group of, how did George Orwell put it? Some pigs are better than others. What was it?
Some pigs
are more equal than others. It's not that some communist elite group of people in the church can then take all of the stuff and then decide, you know, what it is. That's control, that's excessive discipleship, it's not on. Okay? But intense individualism, where we don't take that which the Lord has blessed us with and share it in the church community in various ways, like we give, we give a missions giving as part of our finances. I gave that report towards the end of the year, last year. Okay, do you remember that? Mm-hmm. We take the resources, we use them for various expenses associated with the church, and we reach out and we touch people, that if there was a need in our community, and we have that those funds that have been released by the people, then we can help people that are going through a tough time. We can take them food, we can perhaps help them with their phone bill or whatever it is, as they go through a particular time. And it has to be managed, and it has to be spirit-led, you know, there has to be life in it rather than a mechanical thing where you have to do this, you have to do that. Okay, that's the spirit of what I believe is going on here. And then in verse 46, continuing daily with one accord in the temple. Now, the temple was still standing, even though Jesus had come to do away with all of that stuff. The temple was still standing, and there was a transition period up to the year AD 70. This is another 40 years approximately afterwards that the generational shift shifted away from this physical temple focus to the spiritual Jesus temple focus. It took 40 years for them to start to get the message, and then the Romans sealed the deal. They were smashing the place to the ground, and all we've got left is the Wailing Wall, which is the foundation wall where all the Jews and everyone goes to pray today even. But anyway, they met with one accord in the temple. That was the only public place that they could meet. And then they also broke bread, which is the communion thing, and they possibly had food too, from house to house. So there was a corporate expression, like we're having now, and then there was a house to house thing. And we would like, as things develop in the church, for people that are called and gifted and God has appointed them, to be able to use their homes as reaching out as lights shining in the community, where people can be drawn to those home things and then bring those people to the corporate setting. So hopefully that will begin to happen this year here. anywhere they ate their food. You see, there's a focus here on food here. It's wonderful. I mean, cookies and coffee and whatever, with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all of the people. I mean, that's amazing. There was a shift. It's much like what's happened in our country. There seems to be a little bit of a shift that's taken place in the last month or so. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. Isn't that interesting? Now, we know that it took the enemy a few chapters in the book of Acts to wake up to the fact that his kingdom is starting to crumble, and he then trotted out his persecution. It took a few chapters in the book of Acts for that to happen. But at this moment, the grace of God was so evident that they had favor with all of the people at this time. The enemy was just in shock. You know, what are we going to do? Okay. So, let's look back a little bit in the book of Matthew, the Gospels, to see some sort of foundation that led up to this point here in the book of Acts. So, Peter confesses Jesus as the Christ. Do you know that Christianity is called the Great Confession? And unfortunately, false doctrine, or incorrect doctrine, let me just put it that way, incorrect doctrine, has focused or shifted the focus onto confession of sins to the away from the confession of Christ. Because if you confess Christ, who has come to seek and save you from sin, the whole focus shifts away from sin to Christ. You're drilling down and laying an axe at the root of things that are wrong in your life when you confess Christ and start to put your faith and trust in Him, and His life starts to flow into you as you abide in the vine. You begin to bear fruit, and the sin issue is just where was it? It's gone from our life.
That's good.
But there are a lot of people, oh man, they say, oh, you know what God really wants is to come before us with a heart of contrition and with sorrow in our hearts and with a heaviness for the weight of sin. And oh Lord, I sin this and I confess the sin that and everything. And they spend their whole lives confessing sin rather than the glorious majesty of the Savior who's come to save us from sin. And so Christianity is more accurately defined and referred to historically, doctrinally speaking, as the Great Confession of Christ. And here we've got the account where Peter, looking at verse 13, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" He wants them to start getting specific. He wants to see things in context here. He's starting to pan out into this bigger picture. So they said, "Some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He kind of fits into this whole mishmash of spiritual religiosity here. Oh, well, you know, I'm a little bit of a Buddhist, and I'm a little bit of a Christian, and I'm a little bit of this over here in Confucianism, and I think it's good that we all just coexist together. Well, Jesus is saying, no. You've got to separate yourself out now, because I'm unique. I mean, he didn't put it in these verses this way, but he was unique. One of a kind, come to seek and save the lost, not just to modify our behavior a little bit and be nice in society. No. So, he goes, drills down a little bit more in verse 15. He says to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Gets personal, up close and personal with them. Simon Peter's the one who's now the wet water walker. You know what I was saying earlier on? He's prepared to step out. Even if he does mess up, he's prepared to step out. And he steps out and he says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus puts perspective on it and he says, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter." And he changed his name from Simon the reed, the twisting, turning one, but the solid rock Peter. And on this rock of revelation that you've now got from the Father, I will build my church. So the whole thing of the church now that we talked about earlier on in the book of Acts there, chapter 2, the whole church thing here is going to be built by the Lord on the foundation of Christ as the Messiah. Wow. And the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. It's amazing. So Jesus will build it, the church, and it will work. That's settled. Your next point there, Frank. It's settled. Jesus will build it. He's going to build his church, with or without us. You know, the U2 had the song, With or Without Me. Isn't that anyone who's a U2 fan here? Sorry, guys. Well, anyway, if you YouTube With or With, I think it's With or Without Me. They're kind of a new agey, so a little bit of a Christian kind of group crossover thing there, YouTube. But anyway, Jesus will build his church with or without us. But he's invited us to participate in this glorious project. It's settled. He's going to do it and it's going to work. So he's already indicated that he wants us in. That's his will. Now, what is our will? Do we want in on it? That's our participation. It's our will. He will not force himself off on us. He comes. He's persuasive. He's not overwhelming. But boy, if you want to, you can feel his goodness. Amen? And it's this goodness that leads us to repentance, to change the way of thinking and to move on with him. So, I thought of putting it this way, just as I've expressed it. Really, what it's about is presence. It's his presence. The principles come later. Remember the why, the how, and the what. A lot of people get bogged down in all the 6 steps and the 7 resolutions that we've got to do at the new year. And how many of you know that by the end of January, it's just not working in your life? It's not working. So I think with those words of wisdom from the little girl there, those little moments where we get a glimpse of why, and then the how of his presence, and then the unfolding of that once we've got the why established and his presence, the why of it, the how of it, and the what of it are the principles that follow in line. Don't think that your relationship with the Lord needs to be based on all the things you have to do. It's based on all the things he's already done. And the things that we do are in response to his completed work. A faith response to his completed work. And so his purpose is to build his church. He's got his presence, we've got his purpose, and we've got our participation. What a wonderful formula for success. So let's look now at the church, the habitation of God, because this word habitation or dwelling place comes into the mix here in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 19 through to 22, trying to connect some dots here in this session. Now therefore, you and I, and back in the day he was writing to the Ephesians who were Gentile believers, and they were to join together with the Jewish believers, in the grafted into the vine, you're no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. So this relationship with God is described in terms of something that you and I can relate to, a household that's got a kitchen, it's got a living room, it's got members of the family, it's got safety, it's got protection, it's got identity, it's got all of those things, household. What a wonderful picture. You and I belong to the household of God. We have a sense of belonging. We're not lost. We're not adrift. We're not tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, by everything that's going down in society, the ups, the downs, the mainstream media manipulation of your mind and your emotions and everything like that, and also other kinds of media too. I mean, there is just such a huge, huge, yeah, I say huge, manipulation that's going on of your mind, because the God of this world system makes use of media, makes use of education, makes use of entertainment to shape and mold us in his image. But God wants to take primarily his word and however it's communicated through the media and through song and through books and through tapes and podcasts and websites and everything that are, let's say, on track. Let's just use that expression, on track. God wants to shape us and fit us into his household here. Having been built, this household of God, having been built, it's a building imagery, on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. Ordinary people that he called out of being a fisherman, that he called out of this profession here. Ordinary folk, and he used them. just like the person next to you. So turn to the person next to you and say, hey, ordinary, you are called to be extraordinary in Christ. Amen? Right? Christ being the chief cornerstone. We sang about that in our first song this morning. Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. And the cornerstone was laid in the building at the corner, and it was precisely chiseled, manufactured. They chopped it out, and it was very, very precise. The angles had to be exact, because if the angles were not exact, if you look at my fingers like this, and you twist it out a little bit, this wall over here is going to go off at an angle that's not 90 degrees. And you're going to have a household that you're going to have to compensate for it over here. And you're going to have to build a doghouse like I built before that's got all little patches and little fixes in it because I didn't get the corner exactly right. And when a house like this is built, I was told that if the guys come and they do the framing and they're off by half a centimeter on the framing, the guys who come to do the drywalling have to compensate for that. And they have to do little fixes to try and straighten it out. And then when they come to do the molding and everything, and you get a house that sometimes when you look at some of the lines there, they do this. Mm-hmm. When you get into a point and you look at it. There's a difference between a master builder and a guy like you, me, or someone else. Okay? It's important. Thank God we have a master builder, Jesus Christ. And we have a blueprint by which to build. His word. Wonderful. Looking further down to verse 25, 21, in whom the whole building being fitted together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. It's people now. It's not a physical building, but it's using the imagery of a physical building. Verse 22, in whom you also are being built together for, this is the purpose now, this is the why, this is why we have church. Do we have church just to fill up time to get you out early on a Sunday morning so that you can come here and do your thing? No. A church, a group of people participating in a common cause based on apostolic doctrine, breaking bread together, praying together, is being built together for a dwelling place, a habitation of God in the Spirit. Wow. And that, my friends, makes the church unique. Go to a Hindu temple, go to a Buddhist temple, go to the XYZ whatever place, you will not find the presence of God manifest the same way as in a church. And what we need to do is to build according to his pattern. That's why we want to focus on the book of Acts during this month here. Because the book of Acts gives us a pattern. Sure, their insights had come in the other letters that Paul wrote and Peter wrote and John wrote, and we get insights and we will draw from them. But primarily, the book of Acts gives us a living technicolor movie picture, so to speak, a narrative, an excitement. It's like a James Bond novel, some of the stuff that goes on. It's amazing what went on in the book of Acts. It's a journey. It's an adventure that the early church went on, and it created a dwelling place of God on earth. Jesus came and he went back up to heaven, but he sent the Holy Spirit. And so it has a lot to do with the Holy Spirit. So, building according to his pattern now, just to make a couple of points about building according to his pattern, in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 9 and 10, this is how it's expressed by the Apostle Paul. For we are God's fellow workers, talking about him and his co-laborers in the ministry. You are God's field, you are God's building. He's a little bit ADD in this verse. He goes from a field, you know, farming, to building in one verse, in one phrase. That's funny. That's the way it came through to me. And then in verse 10, according to the grace of God which was given to me as a wise master builder. So the local church might have a pastor and his team that is building, let's say, the church, the local church there. Or it's talking about Jesus being the master builder, and then the pastor, and then by extension you, your own personal life, your family life, your business, the way you live your life. You are a builder. You're either building or you're tearing down. Let's purpose to be builders this year. I have laid the foundation and another builds on it. But let each one take heed, this is Paul now writing, take heed how he builds on it. You see that? Not what, but how. We know the what is a group of people that have been built in relationship with the Lord and with one another according to the way it should be. But we need to take heed how we build it. In other words, our God is interested in what you do and how you do it. The means and the end. Because there's a unfortunate expression in our society that as long as you reach your goal, it doesn't matter how you get there. And if you get there by treading on this person and treading on that person, as long as you get your goal, you're a man or a woman of action. You built this whatever you built. Unfortunately, in the end, God's word has supremacy. Now, what do you do with people who have built kingdoms and built this and built businesses and everything on suspect means? You just pray for the grace of God that they too might be saved. Because Jesus came to seek and save the lost. Whether they're a fancy businessman or this or that or an artist or a movie star or anything, like how you do what you do, how you live your life is important to God. He doesn't want you trampling on anyone to get there. Anyway, the fire will test, verse 13, of what sort it is. Now, I extracted that verse, and it's in my notes here. The fire will test of what sort it is, not what size necessarily, of what sort. So the how and the sort fits in. And we get down to this point here. We, as builders, wise builders, build according to a pattern or a blueprint. And that's why in our next slide here, we've got a picture of the blueprint and the Bible. I believe this Bible here, you know, I keep one here on the desk here. I refer to it in my notes. I don't always open it up and read, you know, from the hard copy here. But this word here, to me, has become a filter and a grid through which I process everything in life. Now, do I do a perfect job of it? Ask Sue, she knows very well. You know, obviously we don't do a perfect job of it, but at least if you've got a grid and you're laying various strands, you can actually filter stuff out, that which is of God and that which is not of God. Right? Because you don't want to continue to drink any Kool-Aid that you might have been offered in society. You want to drink the pure, living, life, health-giving water of God. Hallelujah. And so as a goal, just to kind of wrap up here as a final takeaway here, you've got these young men here playing soccer in about 4 inches of water in some country. I don't know which country it is, the country of LA or I don't know. Anyway, it looks like it's somewhere else. But let's set as a goal this month. Now we're 8 days into the month. And so that means there's 22 days left, 23 days left maybe. You should be able to read 28 chapters of the book of Acts during this time. Because once you get into it, like I said, it's like a James Bond novel. It's really, really exciting when you use your imagination to picture what the heck was going on in the jail with Paul and Silas at midnight when they were singing, when they were totally beaten up. You know, or what actually happened on the day of Pentecost in those little narrow roads where the people were falling all over the place at 9 o'clock in the morning, speaking in tongues and everything like that. What the heck? This is just something that God saw fit to put in the book of Acts for us to see and enjoy and absorb and embrace in our lives. And as I said, as you started the service, I think one of those little things that the girl mentioned there, the little clip that we experienced earlier on, those little changes, those little adjustments, if we can say, God, help me to have a fresh and a life-giving expectation of good, because that's what hope is all about, is an expectation of God's goodness. And to desire it and say, okay, God, I'm not going to play safe. I'm not going to retreat back into those little safe zones, you know, where they have little puppies to stroke and Play-Doh to play with when you don't get your way in society. Right? Mm-hmm. We don't want to retreat into a safe place that doesn't work. Amen? Wow. That's pretty tough, but nevertheless, it's going to help us, I believe. Let's pray right now. Father, we thank you that as we come before you as a group, as I come before you as an individual, and you can individualize this now in your own walk and in areas and challenges that you're facing. Lord, as we come before you, we ask for strength to face the challenge, to have an expectation of things way beyond that which we're thinking about, that we're hoping for even, because you're the God who does exceedingly abundantly above and beyond that which we ask or think. So help us not limit you this year in your goodness, that we can just get by. We want to prosper in the work of our hands as you've promised. We want to enjoy and explore and revel in the abundance that you have for us in every realm: spirit, soul, body, finances, relationships, a total wholeness and wellness, prosperity, true Bible prosperity. Beloved, I pray above all things that you prosper and be in health even as your soul prospers. Spirit, soul, and body. Balance. All to the glory of God. All blessed in order to be a blessing. And so we thank you for that now in Jesus' name. Give us the strength. Amen. So as we partake of communion and ask Becky and Sue maybe to prepare themselves with the communion here, we've got a scripture, John chapter 20, verses 19 and 20. Then at the same day at evening, being the first day of the week when the doors were shut, this is after the resurrection now, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews. They'd locked themselves up. I've just preached about how they suddenly burst forth in the power of the Holy Spirit, and there was favor in the whole city. But right now, they're locked away, they're hidden away, perhaps like some of us in our thinking, in some of our experiences, being locked away, we're fearful of things. Jesus comes to stand in the midst of us and says to us this morning, peace be still. Peace be still. So receive that this morning. And when he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, the completed work, and his disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And so as we participate in this communion, let's be glad that Jesus stands in our midst and that he's the Prince of Peace as an anchor, and that peace is dependent on his completed work. Amen. And let's enjoy the song as it starts.